So prism, so the main difference between pyramid and prism is, so in case of pyramid, you have a base being organic, maybe square, rectangle, triangle, hexagon, okay? So you will have only one polygonal face, so that is called as base. And on the other end, you have an apex, it is just a point, okay? All the points of the corners are connected to this apex, that is the pyramid, okay? Whereas in case of prism, you can find two similar end faces. So in this example, okay, you can find base also, it is a square, and top end face also, it is a square. Similarly, so if we have end faces as square, then the prism is called as square prism. Instead of square, if we have a rectangle as end faces, both bottom and top, okay, so that is called as rectangular prism. Instead of rectangle, if you have triangle on both bottom and top end, okay, then that is called as a triangular prism. Similarly, you may have pentagon, hexagon as end faces, then they are called as hexagonal prism, pentagonal prism, okay. So the major difference is, in case of prism, you can find two end faces, whereas in case of pyramid, you can find only one end face. Whereas they are on the other end, you have apex, okay? That is one thing. Next, how will it define axis of the prism? Okay, so in case of pyramid, we were defining axis of pyramid as this imaginary line connecting apex and center of base, okay? So how will you define axis of a prism? How will you define it? Axis of a prism. Okay, it is the imaginary line connecting end faces. Okay, center of end faces. Okay, that's how we will define axis of prism. Okay, imaginary line connecting center of end faces. That means center of bottom base. Bottom end face and top end face. So if you draw an imaginary line, that is the axis. Next, so similar to pyramid, so here also we have base edges. Okay, in case of there are two end faces. The end face on which the prism rests, that is considered as base. So here this is the base end face. Okay, and this is top end face. Okay. And these are called as lateral faces. So in most of the prisms, so the lateral faces are having rectangular shape, okay? So that's why these lateral faces are also called as rectangular faces. And these edges, okay, the lines connecting corners of bottom end and top end face, so they are called as lateral edges. So this is one lateral edge, this is another lateral edge, this is one more, like that. So here you can find one more lateral edge. In case of square, there are four lateral edges. The another name for lateral edge is longer edge. The reason is, in most of the prisms, okay, except cube, so the length of this lateral edge is longer compared to length of the base edge, okay? So that's why these are also known as longer edges, whereas base edges are also known as short edges, okay? As we discussed, a prism is a polyhedron formed by two equal parallel regular polygonal end faces connected by rectangular side faces. So here this is top end face and this will be bottom end face. And side faces, so these are rectangular in shape. Prism is placed vertically on one of its end faces. The end face on which the prism rests is generally called base. So here in this case, the prism is resting on this end face. So this is called as base and this is called as top end face. The vertical side faces are called lateral faces. So these are lateral faces. In case of pyramid, we were calling these faces as slant because they are inclined, whereas these are perpendicular to horizontal plane and Okay, so that's why these are vertical in orientation, perpendicular to horizontal plane. So that's why these are called as lateral faces. Prisms are named according to the shape of their end faces. For example, this we call it as square prism because the shape of the end face is square. Sides of the end faces are called base edges or shorter edges. So here this is one shorter edge, this is another shorter edge. So like that there are four shorter edges for a square prism. The imaginary line connecting the centers of the end faces is called axis. The edges connecting the respective corners of the two end faces are called longer edges or lateral edges. So here this is one lateral edge or longer edge. So this is another. Like that you can find four lateral edges. Since the shape of the lateral faces are rectangular, they are also called as rectangular faces. The another name for lateral faces is rectangular faces. Okay, so now I will consider the same square prism in SolidWorks model. Okay, so this is the square prism. So here you can see, so this is the top end face. Similarly, at the bottom you have one more face. Okay, so this is bottom end face, the end face on which the prism rests. So that is called as base. In this case, so this is the bottom end face, base, and this is top end face. The sides, okay, so this is called as base edge. Like that, so in base, so you can find four base edges. So this is one base edge, this is second one, this is third one, and this is fourth. Totally there are four base edges. Okay, next, so this is called as lateral face or side face. Okay, and this is called as lateral edge. Lateral edge. So totally for square prism there are four lateral edges. Okay, similarly this is top end face. Top end face also consists of four edges, shorter edges. Okay. Next, you can keep this in different orientation, but initially we will keep in vertical orientation so that in top view we are able to see its true shape of the end faces. In front view we are able to see true height of the prism. Okay. So now this is the isometric view of the prism. What do you mean by isometric view? All those we will discuss in last chapter of this course. Okay. Now in orthographic projection, the same square prism will look like this. If you look from front, so this is the front view of the prism. Actually, so it's a square prism like this, but in front view, since it is orthographic projection, it will look like this. It will be a box, a rectangular box. Okay, this is the front view. Next, in top view, it will look like this. From top, if you look from top, it will look like a square. If you look from front, it will look like a rectangle. Okay, so this is the isometric view. Again, this is wireframe view. So if you consider orthographic view, okay, it will be like this. This is the front view, and this will be top view. Okay. So now I will consider the problem. A square prism having 35 mm sides. A square prism having 35 mm sides of base and 55 mm axis length rests on HP on one of its edges of the base, which is inclined to VP at 30 degree. Draw the projections of the prism when the axis is inclined to HP at 45 degree. This is the given problem statement. Now initially the given solid, that is square prism, is kept in vertical orientation. Okay, so that one of the end face become base and another will be the top end face. Okay, now since it is resting on one of its edges, okay, initially I will take that resting edge towards right, okay, like this. So it is similar to a square lamina resting on side, okay, like that. You should draw the initial top view, okay, draw the square such that it is resting on side. Okay, now so if you look at the square prism, there are two end faces. If you look from top, this is the position of the observer. If you look from top, okay, you are able to see only top end face. If you look from top, okay, whereas bottom end face will be invisible. Okay, initially you will keep a square prism in vertical orientation. You will take the top view. You will look from top, so the top end face is visible. Bottom end face become invisible. Okay, then you will draw the top view. That's why here. So top end face is denoted by A1, B1, C1, D1. That is visible. Bottom end face is denoted by A, B, C, D. Okay, that is invisible. So like this, you will take the top view. Okay, so this is the square prism. Okay, it consists of two end faces. If you look from top, now also you can imagine. So you are able to see only this face, whereas the bottom face become invisible if you look from top. Okay, only you can see the top end face. So next, if you look from front, okay, you are able to see only this face, this lateral face. Remaining all will be invisible. Okay, so this is the front view. You are able to see only one of the lateral face from front. Remaining all are invisible. From top, you are able to see only one of the end faces, that is top end face. Remaining all are invisible. Okay, based on this, so I will first draw top view where top end face is visible, bottom end face is invisible. Next, I will project the points and I will get the front view. In case of front view, I am able to see only one of the lateral faces. Okay, so and remaining lateral faces are invisible. Okay, so based on this, so I will draw initial view. Remaining, so we will discuss later. So I will consider the same problem on SolidWorks. Okay, a square prism and 35 mm sides of base and 55 mm axis length rests on HP on one of its edges of the base, which is inclined to HP at 30 degree. Draw the projections of the prism when the axis is inclined to HP at 45 degree. So first, I will draw XY line. So since it is a square prism and resting on edge, that is side. Okay, so I will draw square such that it is resting on side. So using scale and pencil, so I should draw this. The next, so I will, since the it is having 35 mm sides of base, so the base side length is 35, so this length should be 35. Here also it should be 35. Okay, and interior angle must be 90 degree. So after drawing this, so I will make this length of the sides. Take Okay, next, so I will name the points. So here in case of square prism, since so it is lateral, okay, you don't have slant edges. Instead you are having lateral edges. Lateral edges means so they are vertical in orientation. If a line is perpendicular to HP, the view on HP will be a point. That means here also, so these edges are perpendicular to HP. That means in top view, so this will appear as a point, not as a line. Okay, so that's why both this end and this end will be represented as a point in top view. So here, so if you consider this point, this will represent one lateral edge. So this will represent one more lateral edge. Okay, these corners will represent lateral edges. Okay, since they are perpendicular to HP, they will look like point from top. Okay, when I look from top, so top end face is visible. So that means A1, B1, C1, D1 is visible. That is the top end face. Okay, so at the bottom there is one more face, so that is invisible from top, so that also I should represent. So now I will represent the bottom end face, so that is ABCD. Okay, similarly, so here, B will be inside the bracket. So I am looking from top, so the top end face A1, B1, C1, D1 will be visible and bottom end face will be invisible. Okay, after this we should not connect corners to center. That is applicable only for pyramids. Okay, here since these are lateral edges which are perpendicular to HP, so in top view they will look like point. Okay, but in order to represent the axis we should locate the center. Only for locating center, so I am drawing two diagonals. So these two are construction lines. Okay, then I will locate the center. Okay, after locating, I will erase these diagonals. So in case of prism, you should not connect corners to center. That is only for pyramid. Because in case of pyramid, we have slant edges which are connecting corners to apex. Whereas in case of lateral edges, so it is represented as a point, not as a line in top view. Okay. So now I will name this axis O1, O. So this is the top view. Next, after drawing top view, so I will project the points to get front view. Next, I will also project points of axis. Okay, next, so here you know the height of the prism, 55 mm axis length. So first I will draw the axis, which is a chain dashed line. Length is 55. Okay, next. So I will draw remaining lines. Okay, so this is the front view. So here also from front we are able to see only one of the lateral face. Okay, remaining all are invisible. So the lateral face which is nearer to observer. So if you look from front, okay, so there are four lateral faces. One which is nearer to observer, only that will be visible. Okay, so this is the front view. Only one lateral face will be visible from front. Okay, remaining all this will become invisible. So it will look like this from front. So that's why. So here, for front view, this is the position of the observer. Okay, so C1 D1. Is one of the lateral face CC1 DD1. Okay, so this is a lateral face which is visible. So that's why here you can see C dash C1 dash D1 dash D dash. So this is one lateral face which is visible, whereas on the other side, so there is one more lateral face A dash A1 dash B1 dash B dash. Okay, so this will become invisible. It will remain at back end. Okay, so this lateral face you can see, whereas so this will be at the back side. Okay, and you have common points for remaining two lateral faces. So now I will name the points. So here, this is base. So base is D, D dash. Top end face is D1 dash. So here, this is C1 dash. And this will be C dash. Okay, next. So there is one more lateral face. So that is A dash. That is invisible from front. One dash. B one dash. One dash. Sorry, so here it should be B dash, not B. So this is A dash. Okay, so this is the front view. So that means, so you are able to see only one lateral face. So that is C1 D1 D. Okay, whereas AB B1 A1. So that will be invisible lateral face. Okay, so next, so you should satisfy the first condition. Okay, so here a square prism having 35 mm sides of base and 55 mm axis length rests on HP on one of its edges of the base, which is inclined to VP at 30 degree. So here, so if you consider resting side of the base as AD, okay, this which is represented by this point AD, okay, so this AD should make 30 degree inclination with VP. That will satisfy later. Next, draw the projections of the prism when the axis is inclined to HP at 45 degree. Here we have two inclination. Okay, the edge of the base on which it rests, that is AD, should make an inclination of 30 degree with VP, and the axis of the prism should make an inclination of 45 degree to HP. It is resting on HP. Okay, now since it is resting on HP, we should consider inclination with respect to HP first. Okay, then we should go for satisfying inclination with respect to VP, similar to what we followed in projection of planes. Okay, so if it is resting on HP, we should satisfy inclination with respect to HP first, then we should go for satisfying inclination with respect to VP. Now, so I will consider AD as resting point. So I will leave convenient space. Okay, I will consider a point. So this is D dash A dash. Okay, next. So if I want to make axis inclined at 45 degree, so this we discussed in previous class, I should lift the base for 45 degree. That is 90 minus 45. If I lift the base for 45 degree, automatically the axis will make an inclination of 45. That we discussed in previous class. First, I will draw a line inclined at 45 degree. Okay, next, so I will measure the length of this line. Okay, since it is a square, this also will be 35. Here also it will be 35. From D dash to C dash, it will be having 35. So I will draw a line having length 35. Okay, now so I got these two points. So D dash, A dash, A dash, B dash. I will delete this. Next, so here I forgot to represent axis. So I have represented, but I forgot to name it. Now I will name point. So this is O1 dash. From front, so both the centers of base and top end face both are invisible from front view. So insert the bracket. Okay, now I got D dash A dash and C dash B dash. Next, I should get O. O is at center of C dash D dash. This length is 735, so I will take 17.5. Okay, or using compass, okay, take the radial distance between D dash and C dash. Here, after drawing a 45 degree inclined line, cut an arc, you will get C dash B dash. Next, take radial distance between D dash to O dash. Cut an arc, you will get this point. Okay. Now, since I know the radial distance between D dash and O dash, that is half of 35, that is 17.5, I will draw an arc. This is center. Mm radius. Okay, I will get O dash. Okay, next I will increase the thickness. So this is base. Okay, now I made base inclined at 45 degree. So I should get remaining points. Okay, here either you can take radial distance between D dash and C1 dash, and you can cut one arc, then take 55 mm as radius, cut one more arc, you will get this point. Either you can use compass, you can cut two arcs and you can get points by following that method. Or there is one more method. So you know the relation between base and these lateral edges. They are perpendicular to each other. So after drawing this inclined line, you can draw two lines which are perpendicular to this one. Next, you can take 55 as radius, cut an arc, so you will get the remaining points. You can follow any method. Okay, now, so I will measure the radial distance between this and this. So you should use compass for considering this radial distance. Okay, so this is 65.19. Next, so this radial distance is 55. So this has center and 65.19 as radius. So I will draw an arc. Next, this has center and 55 as radius. I will draw one more arc. Okay, so this is point C1 dash B1 dash. Next, similarly, so radial distance between D dash C1 dash and C dash D1 dash, both are same. So I will take C as center and 65.19 as radius. I will draw an arc. Next, D as center, 55 as radius, I will draw one more arc. So by this I will get point B1 dash A dash. Okay, so now I will name these two points. So this is B1 dash, so here this is D1 dash. Okay, next, so I will connect these points. After this, again from this point in order to get the O1 dash. So we can draw an arc at a distance of 17.5. By taking radius as 17.5, okay, you will get point. So this is O1 dash. Next, I will increase the thickness of these three lines. Next, I will connect axis, points of axis line. So I will measure the angle. So this angle should be 45. Okay, when you make base inclined at 45, the axis also will make an angle of 45 degree. Okay, so what I did was same front view in a different orientation. Okay, I am drawing same front view. Here I draw same front view in a different orientation, such that here axis is vertical, but in order to satisfy the first condition, that is inclined to edge plate 45 degree, axis is inclined to edge plate 45 degree, I tilted this front view such that, so one of the edges of the base is on HP, that is on XY line, that is AD, A dash D dash, okay, it is on HP and axis making 45 degree with HP. Next, so I will project the points and I will get the second top view. So project the points. Next, I will also project points of the axis. After this, so I will name the points. So this is A1. So here it is this projector is for A1 and D1. Okay, I should look into first top view. So here I don't have D1 here, so I have only A1. So this is A point D1. Next, so here B1. Next, C1, D1. Similarly, here on this space, A, B, D. Next, so I will name the points. Okay, so here O1. Okay, next, so after locating points, so I should apply the rule of visibility to connect them. Okay, first rule of visibility is, so we should connect all boundary points. So again, you can go through the rule of visibility similar to projection of pyramids. Okay, first rule of visibility is join the boundary points with continuous line. So now I will do that. So I will join all boundary points with continuous line. So I start from A1. Okay, I will draw okay, first, so I have connected all boundary points. Okay, boundary points means nothing will be left outside it. Outside the boundary, no point will be left. Okay, inside there may be few more points. Okay. Next, you should look at next rule of visibility. Draw visible edges or nearest face with continuous lines. So here, since it is a top view, you are looking from this direction. Observer is looking from this direction. Okay. For the observer, A1, B1, C1, D1 is the nearest face, whereas A, B, C, D is the farthest face. So this face is visible, whereas this one is invisible. Okay, that means if this is the square prism, okay, now it is kept in a orientation like this. Okay, observer is looking from top. If he look from top, he is able to see this face, whereas bottom face, this will become invisible. He cannot see from top this bottom face. So this complete bottom face is invisible to the observer. So that is the meaning. That is the second rule of visibility. Draw visible edges or nearest face with continuous lines. So here, top end face is nearer to observer in top view. So all the ends, all the sides of this top face are visible. So A1, B1 already on the boundary. B1, C1. So it should be a continuous line because it is the side of the nearest end face. Okay, next C1, D1 already on the boundary, D1, A1 already on the boundary. Next, the sides of the farthest face. Again, draw invisible edges or farthest face with dashed lines. So now, AB, though it is invisible, since it is on the boundary, it is a continuous line. Okay, for boundary, irrespective of visible or invisible, you should connect with continuous lines. Okay. AB already on the boundary connected, BC already on the boundary connected, CD already on the boundary connected. Remaining is D to A. Okay. So D to A I should represent with dashed line. Like this. Okay. Next. So here there are no lateral edges to connect. So all the lateral edges on the boundary itself. Okay, so next thing is I will represent axis. Okay, since it is not overlapping with any other lines, so I will represent axis using chain dashed line. Okay, like this. So this is the second top view. Next, so you should look at the last condition. So rest on HP on one of its edges of the base, which is inclined to VP at 30 degrees. So here, this square prism is resting on one of the edges of the base. That resting edge is AD. Here you can see AD. So this point, okay, it is the resting edge AD. Now it is perpendicular to VP. So AD, this line, okay, so is perpendicular to XY means perpendicular to VP. But according to given condition, this should make an angle of 30 degree. So in the last position, you must also be worried about beta angle. Okay, the question is whether to find out beta angle for this problem or not. Is it required or not? Okay. Now, so we should make this AD, that is resting edge of the base, inclined at 30 degree. Now, next you should look at whether we have true length of AD or not. Whether we have true length of resting edge or not. Okay, initially, in the initial top view, so the true length of AD is 35. Okay, here also it remains 35 only. That means because it is resting on edge. Okay, so the length of AD remains same. No changes. So since we should make this AD inclined at 30 degree, we have true length of AD. Given inclination is also true, so need not find out beta. Directly we can make it inclined at 30 degree. Okay, so since I don't have enough space here, so first I will draw a line parallel to XY. Next I will draw a 30 degree inclined line. Draw a 30 degree inclined line. Okay, next on this line I will mark a points A and D. So I will consider a point, two points. Distance between these two should be 35. And then I will draw a line. Okay, since it is a dashed line here also that should be a dashed one only. Okay, you are reproducing the same second top view in different orientation. If it is continuous line here also that should be continuous. If it is dashed here also that should be a dashed line. Okay, so I have drawn A and D inclined at 30 degree. So now I will name these points. So this is A and this is B. So next, so I should get remaining points. If you observe properly, so AD and the points of C, C1, D1. Okay, so if you draw the relation between AD and this line, so they are perpendicular. Relation between again AD and B to A1, again it is perpendicular. Okay, so if I draw a line passing through D and A and perpendicular to this line, so I am able to get remaining points. This is by observation. Okay, so I will draw a line passing through D and perpendicular to AB. This line should be perpendicular. This angle should be 90. Okay, similarly, I will draw one more line. So using protractor and scale, you should draw this line. Okay, so after drawing lines perpendicular to AD, that is this 30 degree line, So I will measure the distance and I will get the remaining points. Okay, I will measure the radial distance between D to C. Okay, then D as center. So this radius, that is 24.75. I will draw an arc. So I will get point C. Similarly, A as center, again same radial distance, so I can get point P. I will name these points. So this is C and this is B. Okay, next. So I will measure the distance between D to C, radial distance between D and C. D and C1. Okay. Next, so by drawing arc, D as center and D to C1 as radius, I will draw an arc. So here also, D as center. Okay, I'll draw arc and I will get okay, this is C1 and here it will be D1. Okay, next, so after this, so I will consider the radial distance between C1 and D1. And C1 as center, I will draw an arc. Radial distance is 24.46. Okay, then I will extend this line. I will get the next year also from D1. So radius is 24.46. I will get the point. So this is D1. This is A1. After getting the points, so I will connect them. Okay, so this is, then I should connect so C1 to B1 also. C1 to D1. Sorry, this is NA getting correctly. Okay, so this is B1. So then I will increase the thickness. Okay, so this is the final top view. I have redrawn this second top view in a different orientation. So here the resting gates AD is perpendicular to VP, but given condition is it should be inclined at 30 degrees. So first I have drawn a 30 degree inclined line, and 30 degree inclined line I marked AD. Okay, then by drawing two perpendicular lines passing through this D and A, I am able to get remaining points by taking the radial distance and marking it here. So I am able to get remaining points. Okay, after this, next procedure is I should project the points from second front view and final top view, and I should get the final view, final front view. So I will do that. So B, C, E, D. Okay, so I will project B1, A1. C1 D1, and I will also project. So here I should also get axis points. Okay, so in this final top view I should also get the axis points. I forgot to get that, so now I will get the axis points. Okay, so I will measure the radial distance between C to O. Okay, next C as center, and this as radius. I will draw one arc. Next B as center, and again 21.43 is radius, so I will draw an arc. Okay, so I will get a point. Okay, so what I did was, so if I know point C and B, okay, I should get point O. Okay, I can take radial distance between C to O and B to O. I can cut two arcs and I can get point O. Similarly, here also, I will follow the same procedure. I will take radial distance between B1 and O1. D1 as center, so I will draw an arc 1.35 here also. So this is O and this is O1. And now I will connect these two points. So this is the representation of axis. Okay, next, so I will name these points. A1 dash. So here this is B1 dash. C1 dash. Next D1 dash. Okay, similarly here, so we'll start with A dash. Dash D dash. So I will project points of axis O. So here it is. Next O1. O1 dash. So this is O1 dash. And this is O dash. Okay, so after locating the points, so again I should apply a rule of visibility. First I should connect boundary points. Okay, I will start from A. I will go on connecting all boundary points. Okay, first I will connect all boundary points like this. Okay, that means nothing will be left beyond that. Okay, while connecting boundary points, so you must be very careful. Next, after connecting boundary points, so I will look into second rule of visibility. So this is the final front view. That means you are looking from this direction. That means A1, B1, C1, D1 is visible, and ABCD is farthest face and it will become invisible. Nearest face is visible to the observer. So here, this is the final front view. In order to get final front view, you are looking from this direction. Here, this is the nearest end face. A1, B1, C1, D1 is the nearest end face. Whereas ABCD is the farthest end face. Since A1, B1, C1, D1 is nearest end face, all the sides of this end face is visible. So A1, B1 already on the boundary, B1, C1 already on the boundary. Next I should connect C1 to D1 with continuous line because it is the nearest end face. Next, D1 to A1 dash. Okay, next, farthest end face, that is ABCD, is invisible. That means these edges should be dashed lines. So AB, A dash, B dash. So this should be a dashed line. Next, BC, that is B dash, C dash in front view. It's a dashed line. Okay, next, CD already on the boundary, DA is also already on the boundary. For boundary, this is not applicable. Okay, boundary always should be connected with continuous lines. Okay, next. So here I should look into other lateral edges. Lateral edges means lines connecting A, A1, B, B1, C, C1, D, D1. Okay. A, A1 already connected on the boundary. Next, B, B1, B dash, B1 dash. It should be connected. Okay. So since this point B is connected by two dashed lines. Okay, first I can go for drawing one more dashed line. When I go for drawing one more dashed line, it is crossing continuous line, that is possible. This we discussed in previous class in detail. Okay. Next, CC dash already on the boundary connected. Next, I should connect D dash, so D1. Okay, CC1 already in the boundary, D1 I should connect. Again, since so D is connected by two continuous line, I will go for drawing one more continuous line and it is crossing dashed line, that is possible. So I will connect with continuous. Okay, next. So I have connected all lateral edges and edges of base and edges of interfaces. Okay, only left thing is, so I should connect axis points O1 and O1 dash. So I should use chain dash line. Okay, so this is the final front view.